Well, today on the bench we have a partially disassembled HP thingy that Ken has reverse engineered, so it will need some repairs. But Ken, what have you found about it?
So basically, this is a board for programming and driving these character modules.
The LED thing, go slower so I can actually pull on it. So it's an internal HP demonstrator. It's not an HP product, something that the marketing people had to show off their beautiful displays.
And they are beautiful.
Hopefully because they weren't cheap. Hello and welcome back. Today we take a break from our arduous multi-part electronic repair projects. We will rest our brain cells with something cute, unusual, and hopefully not terminally broken. This sweet little HP box that I had never heard of before. This is a gift from team member Eric, aka Tube Time. Somehow Eric knows that I am easily excited by vintage HP stuff. I wonder how he figured that out. I think he got it from our local electronics flea market, at which internal development stuff from Silicon Valley's underbelly occasionally dredges up. We quickly teased out that this must have been an internal HP sales box to demonstrate the capabilities of the newly introduced HDSP-211X series of LED displays. The HDSP-2112 appears in the 1988 Optoelectronics catalog. The original colors were the red 2112 and the yellow 2111. HP added the orange 2110 and the green 2113 in 1991, as well as some katakana Japanese character versions. Let me know if you have any of these. The sales demo box came without its display chips, so I made my usual incantations and large Patreon-sponsored offerings to the eBay gods, and got a pair of new old ones from an Asian vendor. They just were delivered back to their Silicon Valley birthplace. These were made by the HP Optoelectronic Fab in San Jose. The fab is still here today, now owned by LumiLEDs. The chips were definitely more old than new. They were well used and scratched up, so new old stock my ass. But if they work, it should be worth it. Unlike the equally gorgeous but earlier HP 2010 devices that we discovered during our HP 9825 repair-a-thon, the 2110s are far more user-friendly. In the earlier 2010s, it was up to you to light up each single pixel in the matrix and load the bits in a shift register for each column. The 2110 has a far more complex driver chip in it, complete with RAM and ASCII decoding. It interfaces to a microcontroller with a few address and data lines. Three address bits specify the position of the character you want to display, and you just send the ASCII code of the character on the data lines. The display does all the rest. There are some more control lines and registers to do the more complicated stuff like user-defined characters, brightness and blinking, but if all you want to do is display ASCII characters, it couldn't be easier.
So basically it has an Intel 8748 microcontroller that reads the switches, which have these various functions, and then it controls your little modules, which actually have flash memory and RAM in them, so you can reprogram them with characters that you want.
It does ASCII, but you can do your own characters in NVRAM, 16 of them, I think. And then you program them row by row, and it's a row of 5 dots, that's where you have 5 switches. So there was absolutely nothing available as far as documentation.
So yeah, it has an input labeled DC, but how much is a mystery, and then a switch, so you can use either the DC input or the leaky NiCad batteries.
Oh, there's a switch?
Yeah.
It's one or the other.
It's labeled DC, or charge, or battery.
Oh, okay.
Here, there's a 7805 voltage regulator for when you're running off the DC input. And then there's a few diodes for when you're charging the battery or running off the battery.
Okay.
And when you're using the battery, it's not otherwise regulated. So hopefully you're replacing the battery with the right voltage of cell.
And then the batteries, they don't look too good. Of course, they have nickel cadmium, and they're a little bit spicy.
Yeah, so
fuzzy.
Not gonna taste it.
I have some old ones in the cup just behind you. It's taken from an old battery pack, an RC battery pack, so they're the same size. This will hold charge, so we'll put them in. And the modules. So these guys, believe it or not, they're still made. Broadcom, which is former Avago, which is former HP, will sell them to you at $80 a pop.
Which is expensive, but there's a lot going on in here.
All right. I bet you this is for the military market. Right? It was a mill part originally, so they kept doing it. I got those on eBay. They were less than $80, but still expensive. They are sought after. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right, and that's where the fun begins. I have my nice Chinese welder thingy. And just go pick, poke, just press, and there you go. So this is not sponsored at all, but this is a little unit. A with Z. A with Z. And spot welder UF20B works like a charm.
So you're putting it back together?
Yeah, I made a new battery pack thanks to my spot welder, and then I have to do this one, and I can't freaking recall. Not entirely sure of the purpose. Maybe you slide a filter. There must have been a set of filters, and depending on the color of the display you install, you slide in a different filter with a different color.
So why would you want a filter?
So you have more contrast. So my batteries weren't looking that good, actually, the replacement. One of the elements started corroding, so I'm not sure that it will work. Okay, so that's the unit when it's finished. Right. And we'll soon discover what the buttons do, and they give you a little instruction manual here. Reset, scroll, flash, custom character, row entry, call up existing characters.
And the feature list in case you want to make an impulse purchase of this.
Yeah, this is really annoying. You have to just go in there. And then that is higher than your filter. This goes to the marketing people, so the engineers are not very motivated.
I would do one at a time, just in case.
Just in case I burn the other one. And yeah!
Ooh, look at that.
Okay, well, you know, my battery pack works. Hey, Eric, come see your thing. Okay. I'll put two, see if my battery pack can do two at a time. Oh, sure can. So yes, as you said, they are in parallel. Scroll.
So that's so you can compare two of them.
I lost power.
Oh.
So DC, what do you reckon the DC should be?
So I'm thinking about 8 volts.
We can start at 6 and then end up at 110.
Well, that escalated quickly.
All right. So let's try it again. Didn't go through two diodes from the...
No, it goes through the regulator when you're driving it from DC. And the diodes are for the battery.
So I should be like 7 volts and be fine. All right, how does it look on camera? Yeah, it for the camera, it really needs a filter. Let's see if I can put the second one to it. Okay, I made my my special character. Yeah, I'm not sure what that is. Real trouble with the focusing. Okay, your turn. Probably need to scroll.
Okay.
There you go, you got it. Ooh.
There, heart from Mother's Day.
I feel completely outdone here. Okay, so now I have found a way how to film this. Oh, you have more than one?
Well, we'll see.
A bunny? It is a bunny. Or a smiley face.
No, it was supposed to be a Bitcoin symbol, but I like totally messed it up, so.
Okay, Eric, your turn for the character. Custom character. We'll get to the next one. There you go.
Okay.
That's your character.
And then switches and then row entry.
Okay. And then this is what, 5x7?
Yes. Ooh, an IBM lozenge. Oh, nice. A carrot.
There.
Oh.
That's a nice one.
Interesting.
I don't know what it is, but...
Oh, so we have to pedal it to the Unicode.
Oh, you gave me a great idea.
Oh, no.
You can do the next, don't erase this one, go...
Custom character?
Yeah, custom character, so you get the next one.
Okay.
All right.
There.
The group mark symbol?
Exactly.
Oh, it's a group mark word mark. Excellent. Okay, this one needs an explanation. It has to do with the IBM 1401 that we work on at the Computer History Museum. And more specifically as a special character that is super important to program the tape drives and indicate the end of a record. Although the IBM 1403 printer can print it, almost any other device has an issue with it, which is why you see it hand-drawn in many of the manuals, including IBM's own. But now the problem is solved thanks to Eric's rendition on our display, and also by its inclusion in Unicode, courtesy of Master Ken himself.
Which I got added to Unicode.
Oh.
You did?
Thanks.
Yeah.
Oh!
It was like the 1401 symbol that wasn't in Unicode, so I'm like, hey you guys, put it in. And so they did. It doesn't seem to be too popular with the font designers.
I don't know why. It's a nice character.
So yeah, I got the group mark, the Bitcoin symbol, and 4 half stars added to Unicode.
Half stars? What do you...
Well, like if you have a movie that's rated 4.5 stars, someone on Hacker News complained that half star was missing.
So you need to design a half star.
There you go.
That's a tricky one to do.
Not enough dots.
Let me try the Bitcoin one more time.
Oh. It does work. It is a Bitcoin.
There we go. Now I just need to reprogram the microcontroller to do some Bitcoin mining, and away we go.
Okay, the last character is for you.
It's erasing Mark's character.
Okay.
And if you mess up, you just go and do all the rows and start over again.
It's an hourglass.
It's an hourglass. Very logical.
He tries to mine bitcoins on this thing.
Okay, you guys are all better than me. So I found some of the filter material and it makes a huge difference visually. I don't know if on the camera you will see it. But...
Several days later.
Here we go. I made a filter with little pieces of red plastic, which I bought on Amazon. Jeff Bezos came to my home and delivered it personally. Just kidding. And now it looks real good. And then now intensity works fine. By the way, that thing consumes an incredible amount of current. It's 0.5 amp for those two displays, so 250 milliamp per display. Beautiful HP display. Still made today, I can't believe it, but it deserves to be still made.